You can look like reporters and news broadcasters.
That's right. I'm gonna look, it's breaking news.
Yeah, the pace of research just a little slower than breaking news.
Yeah. Welcome to USC Facebook Live from Studio A. We'd like to thank our host, the Annenberg School for Communications and Journalism. My name is Julie Zissimopoulos. I am an associate professor in the Solpreis School of Public Policy and the Schaefer Center for Health Policy and Economics. I'm an economist by training. I direct a center that's funded by the National Institute on Aging that is focused on how we may reduce racial and ethnic disparities in the risk of Alzheimer's disease and also the care for people who live with the disease. Currently, I am sitting on a National Academy of Science committee, and we are charged with thinking about what is the social science and behavioral research that we should be conducting on Alzheimer's disease.
Hi, I'm Christian Pike. I'm a professor in the USC Leonard Davis School of Gerontology. I'm a neurobiologist by training. I work on the mechanisms of Alzheimer's disease in various experimental models and try to translate what we find in those models to therapeutic interventions eventually in humans.
So this month is Alzheimer's Awareness Month. So interestingly, November was designated the Alzheimer's Awareness Month back in the early 1980s. And at that time, there was an estimated 2 million Americans with Alzheimer's disease. Mm. So today, we're at about 6 million with Alzheimer's and related dementias. And that's 2 million more than the population of the second largest city in the U.S., which is Los Angeles. And in our projections, we think it'll be rising in the next 30 years to about 12 million.
Yeah, the numbers are scary. So today we're going to discuss some of the latest advances in Alzheimer's disease research, share some of our insights. Julie and I are just two of several dozen researchers at USC who are focused on Alzheimer's disease. And we range across a broad spectrum from people working in, at a very molecular level through different experimental models up into development of therapeutics, clinical trials, and then evaluation of huge data sets to understand how the disease is impacting society at large. So we know a lot, but there's also a lot we don't know. One of the things we want to do to begin this conversation is talk about an interesting finding in the field, and that is of the nearly 6 million people in the U.S. with Alzheimer's today, almost two-thirds of them are women.
So that is very interesting, and being a person who focuses on sort of the population statistics, one of the kind of driving factors is that we're all just living a lot longer than we used to.
Yeah.
And the population today that's over 65 is actually larger than the population that's under 5 years old for the first time ever.
Yeah.
So that's 50 million Americans. And one statistic that we've seen over the last 50 years is this longevity has increased more for women than men. So I'm curious to hear from your perspective, is this difference in risk of Alzheimer's between women and men primarily driven by the longevity? I know your research has looked at other factors that drive these differences.
Yeah, those are all excellent points. What we do know is that the single greatest risk factor for Alzheimer's disease is age. So as you say, as the society ages, the numbers of cases are just going to increase. And women are living longer, so that appears to be part of the equation. But we think that there's more than just that. One of the things when we look at age-related diseases, when there's sex differences in them, so for example, take osteoporosis. Both men and women get osteoporosis. It's much more common in women. And we think that the primary reason for that is that they lose estrogen at the time of menopause, and treating them with estrogen kind of negates that type of effect. So some of what we have with sex differences in aging is that men and women have different primary sex hormones. Men have high levels of testosterone. Women have relatively high levels of estrogen. We both have both of those hormones, but different levels of them. And then with aging, men beginning at about age 30 have this kind of slow trickle down of their testosterone. So the time they're in their 70s, that can have clinical manifestations. Women, estradiol is high throughout adulthood, and then at time of menopause very rapidly and more completely decreases than testosterone is. So you have different hormones and different trajectories, and I think that that's part of it. My prior work and those of several others around the country and around the world have found that testosterone loss in men is a risk factor, estrogen loss in women is a risk factor for dementia. So that's part of it. I think a new idea that we're just looking at is that there are sex differences in a variety of different neurological conditions, and not only the numbers of them, but the manifestation of the disease in terms of its symptomatic presentation, things like autism, schizophrenia, ADHD, these types of disorders. And these all occur in young life.
Right.
So there's no age changes in hormones. So what's going on? And we're beginning to ask the question, maybe Alzheimer's is like that there's something inherently different between men and women, and perhaps the female brain is inherently more vulnerable to aspects of Alzheimer's disease, but it's not manifested until old age because that's when the disease shows up. So we're focusing on very early development when the male and the female biologically go through a process called sexual differentiation, when they separate into becoming female or male. And we're looking at that in rodent models, and we're looking at that in really interesting human studies. And the initial results suggest that it does have a significant impact in your propensity to develop dementia. That is, the more female-like you are, the more vulnerable your brain is to developing dementia. So it's an interesting area.
So one of the other big differences, sort of the heterogeneity and risk of Alzheimer's disease that I and my colleagues have been interested is in racial disparities in the risk of disease. And so we've been looking at it from the population level. And so what we and others have found is that, you know, African Americans are about 2 times more likely to develop Alzheimer's or other dementias than non-Hispanic whites. And Hispanics are about 1.5 times. But there, we've been mostly focused on the environmental and the socioeconomic factors, as well as the health factors. So there are, you know, several kind of health-related factors that we know are associated with the disease. So these are chronic conditions like diabetes and dyslipidemia and hypertension. And Hispanics and African Americans have higher rates of these diseases, and they're very prevalent across the 65 and older population. I think there's about a quarter of Americans over age 65 that have diabetes, almost 70% have hypertension. And then the other factors that are associated with increased risk in these groups is other socioeconomic factors, like where you live and how the air pollution and the environmental factors around you affect your brain development. Education, we found, has played a big role. So the higher educated you are, the less likely you are to acquire the disease. And these factors, of course, there's going to be genetic factors. So you had focused with men and women on the sort of the steroid and the estrogen hypotheses. What do we know about sort of the genetic factors that are driving some of these disparities that we see?
I think it's a really important point, and it brings to mind the topics you're mentioning about socioeconomic status and air pollution. Our colleague Caleb Finch recently published a very influential paper called the AD Exposome, and the idea with this is that our risks for Alzheimer's disease, like they are for other conditions like cancers, are a combination of our genes and our environmental factors, and there's all these external factors, including where you're, whether you're living in a city or rurally, and whether you have high exposure to inflammatory conditions, socioeconomic status, all of this can have important effects. So in thinking about these, what you have then are interactions between what your environment is and what your genes are. And these gene-environment interactions can be very, very profound. One of the areas that we've been looking at recently is what's called APOE4. I'm sure you're familiar with that.
Of course.
APOE4 is the most significant genetic risk factor for late onset Alzheimer's disease. When Alzheimer's runs in your family, most often it's associated with this APOE4. And it's not a mutation. It's kind of a we call a polymorphism. It's a normal variation in our genes. And only a small proportion of the U.S. society, maybe 12 to 15%, have got APOE4. But in the Alzheimer's population, it's 40 or 50%. Mm-hmm. So it's a significant risk factor. And there's two interesting things about that. One is that the effects of APOE seem to be more robust in women than they are in men. Mm-hmm. Now, the magnitude of that effect kind of varies across studies. Our colleague, Art Toga, published a paper about 2 years ago showing that the effect of APOE in the bias for women may be limited to a specific age range. Many other studies have shown the same type of effect. Mm-hmm. So why that might also be why women are more vulnerable to it. The other thing is, and this gets at the heart of this exposome, APOE tends to affect our inflammatory tone. Mm-hmm. And it then, we think it interacts with a variety of environmental factors. So Caleb Finch's group and others here on the USC campus have shown that it interacts with air pollution. So living in LA, we're exposed to a lot of smoggy days, and air pollution drives risk for dementia, mm-hmm. and that is affected by APOE4. So you have APOE4 and air pollution, mm-hmm. it's worse. So you can imagine now, if APOE and females are more at risk, and then you can start mixing that in with other mm-hmm. factors, and this likely also interacts with things we've been looking at in my lab, like obesity.
Right.
Now, you've also looked at a variety of different comorbidities, hypertension
yes.
and obesity, and
right.
tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, so I started talking a little bit about how these very prevalent conditions in the population are associated with Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. And what's very interesting is when you look at what's going on with the population, Alzheimer's disease over time, you actually see that incidence has been declining over the last decade. And at the same time, these chronic conditions have been increasing. So more and more people have diabetes. So we were asking in our research, so how can this be that we have increasing rates of these diseases that are associated with mm-hmm. it, but we see declines in incidence? And it's not just in the U.S. We see these in other industrialized countries, this declining incidence. So where we went to look, and it kind of brings back to what you had mentioned about inflammation, is we went to look at the treatments that we have for these diseases. Mm-hmm. I'm specifically looking at the use of statins for treating right. dyslipidemia and antihypertensives. And we're not the only people that have been looking at this. How we look at it is by following millions of Medicare beneficiaries' claims. So we can see the drugs that they're taking, the diseases that they get, mm-hmm. and we can watch them over time. And what we and others have found is that high use of statins, so if you've been taking a statin to treat your dyslipidemia for a long period of time, your risk of onset of Alzheimer's is lower than if you had taken it for a shorter period of time or had less use of it. And one of the hypotheses that our neuroscientist colleagues on this work have helped us think about is maybe it's not just that it's affecting the serum cholesterol level, so reducing your beta amyloid accumulation, mm-hmm. but it's also affecting inflammation, because that's one thing that statins do outside of what they're supposed to do, which is reduce your serum cholesterol levels, is that they reduce inflammation. So this kind of works in with a little bit about what you're talking about, with there's inflammation that's driving some of this. And maybe we can think a little bit more about these different hypotheses on what's driving. Is it beta amyloids? Is it inflammation? Is it tau? Is it a combination? And is this part of the issues why we're having so many problems finding
wow.
drugs?
That's a very loaded,
forward.
Large question. that's at the heart of where Alzheimer's disease is right now. What's causing it? We know so much, but yet we're at this point where how can we have no therapies? We've
right.
spent billions on this, and 99% of the clinical trials have failed. So are we at the wrong target? What's the problem? And as you're mentioning, I think that the two long-standing hypotheses have been that it's caused either by this protein called beta amyloid or by this other protein called tau, which becomes abnormally modified, called hyperphosphorylated. Both of those are the key characteristics of the disease, and both of them are tied with degeneration of the brain. And there's arguments in the field about which one do we target? Do we target both? How do we do this? I will say that as of right now, I think that one of the things the field is thinking is that to do our clinical trials, we have been trying to focus on the earliest stages of Alzheimer's mm-hmm. disease. So finding people who are just right. showing the initial clinical mm-hmm. evidence of dementia. That was the best that we could do, and so these trials are based on that. What we've come to realize over the last decade is as our ability to detect the disease, to diagnose it, has occurred much earlier with a variety of biomarkers in our mm-hmm. cerebral spinal fluid, a variety of very sophisticated imaging techniques. We can now detect the pathology of the disease 10, 15 years before we're having any mm-hmm. clinical manifestation, because the disease, we believe, takes a couple of decades. So what might be is that the trials have failed in part because we are treating people when they already had full pathology and they were just showing clinical signs. What we need to do now is take a step back and, using our improved diagnostics, begin trials 5-10 years earlier and see if it's going to work. So that's going on now, but that's going to be a few more years of delay until we begin to get those answers.
Right. Well, that's interesting because, we talk a lot about waiting for our clinical trial to come through yeah. and treat everybody or find prevention. But one of the areas that we've been working on is thinking about, well, while we wait, what can we do now? Mm-hmm. Not only to think about prevention, but also to think about treating people who currently are living with the disease right. and the millions of family caregivers. And one of the areas that we're particularly looking at is sort of how to reduce the burden on this caregiving community. Right. So the costs of Alzheimer's disease are incredibly high. We've been quantifying these costs both for today and going forward in the future. And they're already currently at about $400 billion. And that's wow. just healthcare costs, so the healthcare services, but also the dollar value of all the hours of informal care that family members provide.
Now, how do you quantify the burden and the cost on the family members and the caregivers?
So we do it in a couple of ways. So the one way that we do it is we literally take their hours that they spend caring. And because Alzheimer's is a progressive disease and people can live with it for 10 years and they need a lot of care, particularly as the disease progresses, sure. The number of hours is substantial. So we take the number of hours that they receive this care from family members, and we value it looking at, well, what if they went into the marketplace and paid for formal care? And we end up with a number that's over $100 billion wow. for today's in today's dollars. But looking forward, if we don't come up with a treatment or we don't figure out ways to prevent the disease, right. We're looking at, in 2050, healthcare costs and just the value of informal caregiver cost of $1.5 trillion. And this is mostly being paid for either out of pocket, Medicare pays about 75%, and Medicaid. So not only is this a burden on families, but it's an enormous burden on our healthcare system and burden on our future generations. If we're right. paying for all of this care, then what are we giving up in terms of investing in our younger generation?
So from your perspective, how do we go about addressing this? How do we bridge this gap where we have this huge financial burden awaiting us, and we've got a few years with the NIH annually increasing funding mm-hmm. towards Alzheimer's mm-hmm. disease saying, oh my gosh, we really do have a huge right. problem. Let's throw more dollars at it, and, right. and we're going to come up with an answer. Where do you think that answer
Where are
is?
Some of these answers. Yeah. It's a great question. So the way that I think about it is, we have this term that we use, burden, and this population burden is composed of the number of people with the disease, how long they have the disease, and then how much it costs. And while we wait on the side of reducing the numbers or reducing the time in which people have the disease, there's a lot we can do on the cost side. So we can think about policies that support caregivers. So we want to make sure that caregivers don't have to leave the workforce, that they have paid leave when they're an adult child caring for an elderly parent. We can also think about our healthcare system. So how is our healthcare system treating individuals with dementia, and are they living quality of lives? Are they living long or short lives? And we have different ways in which Medicare treats beneficiaries. We have Medicare beneficiaries that are in our fee-for-service program, and they go and see whatever doctor that they want to at the when they need care. We have Medicare Advantage programs that try to coordinate care across different providers, and we have accountable care organizations. But we don't really know what kind of healthcare systems can improve the quality of life. And if you can improve the quality of life with people living with the disease, we have several studies that have shown that it also improves the quality of life and the burden of caregiving. So there are ways that we can think about addressing some of these costs now through policy. And think about, you know, not only just reducing the cost, but who's paying for the costs. So another issue that we have to think about is, are we truly reducing these costs, or are we just shifting it?
Passing them on
to another location. We're just passing it on. Yeah. So, you know, another really interesting trend is thinking about moving individuals who live with the disease out of institutional facilities and keeping them in the community. It definitely saves money for Medicare and Medicaid if they're paying for any of the services, particularly Medicaid, because Medicare doesn't pay for long-term care.
Right.
But are we just shifting it to families? Then are they now taking up the costs? And is that what we want as a society? And
it's
that solving some of our issues?
So that's you know, that's one approach. And then we've got investigators like me, and we're working on a variety of molecular mechanisms. What is that targeted therapy? And so a lot of the work that I've been doing works on genetically engineered mice. So mice don't get Alzheimer's disease, but we can generate mice that develop Alzheimer's disease. And we've gotten really good at curing mice. Yeah. The problem is translating those cures to humans. And so there's a couple different areas that I think the field is looking at. Mm-hmm. One of them, as you mentioned, is inflammation. Mm-hmm. So as we started off, we're saying one of the largest risk factors, or probably the greatest risk factor for Alzheimer's, is simply getting old.
Right.
So what is it about aging that is driving the disease? And one of those, we think, is inflammation throughout the body and in the brain. We're called neuroinflammation. So there's a bunch of studies looking at affecting different aspects of neuroinflammation. And if we can stop that or reduce it, that will help us affect Alzheimer's disease as well as a variety of other age-related conditions. Another approach is to say, what is it, amyloid? Is it tau? What are these different mechanisms? Maybe we don't have to worry if it's just one pathway. Mm-hmm. Why don't we do something called, you know, strategies that are pleiotropic, that are using multiple different targets at the same time? And then the other one, I mean, it's so depressing. After being in this business for 30 years, working on defined molecular mechanisms, people say, I always say 3 or 5 years, we're going to have it.
Mm-hmm.
And that just keeps happening, and we don't have the cure. So I've said, okay, we're going to get there.
Mm-hmm.
But in the meantime, what do you do? And I think this is where we can almost go back to that exposome idea. We can modify, there's modifiable factors in the way that we live our lives. We can, importantly, is diet and exercise, right? So there's not one specific diet for Alzheimer's disease. But there are a variety of healthy diets. The Mediterranean diet has shown to be very effective in terms of brain aging. Increasing exercise is tremendously important. If we take our little genetically engineered mice and we put them on healthy diets, the Alzheimer's pathology goes down. If I take my mice and I put them on a high-fat diet, they not only get fat, but their pathology becomes greatly accelerated. If we get them on little exercise wheels, and mice love to run on exercise wheels, everything about the brain improves and the pathology goes down. So there's a lot of things that we think we can do in terms of modifying lifestyle that are important. And then a lot of the mechanistic work and targeted interventions are in development, and some of them maybe they exist still.
Yeah. So, you know, it brings up a really important point, which is that to make a big impact, we really don't necessarily need a home run. We don't need to find the trial that cures the disease. Even just small modifications can reduce risk. And part of this work that we looked at trying to quantify the cost, we also looked at what's the value of a hypothetical innovation in treatment that doesn't cure the disease, but it just delays its onset.
Slows it down.
Just slows it down. Mm-hmm. And what's remarkable about is the size of the impact just a delay in the onset of the disease can have from a societal level. So, for example, I threw out that 1.5 trillion number, which is a very big and scary number when you think about the cost of disease. Well, if we can find something, whether it be diet and exercise or a treatment that can delay the onset for 1 year, we can save society $200 billion. Wow. 5 years, over $600 billion. So these incremental movements that you talked about along the way can have important implications for the population. So I guess one thing that I'd love to ask you before we wrap up is, you know, is there any area of this research that you think is being overlooked? You know, I know there's a lot of research going on at USC and around the world, but is there areas that we're overlooking from your perspective?
I think we have been overlooking this topic we've hit on a few times today, is this inflammation. And we keep thinking it's important. And one of the reasons that we've overlooked it is long ago we did these different drug trials on anti-inflammatory, mm-hmm. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory over-the-counter type drugs, and nothing really happened. And I think it's because the complexity of the immune cells, you can't just turn them on or turn them off, and their relationship to the disease is a very complex one. Mm-hmm. So it goes all the way back to what are the basic components of aging. Once we get, you know, in the School of Gerontology, a lot of the members are mm-hmm. focusing just on longevity and health span. Once we get at some of those key features of the mm-hmm. aging, we can improve it, as you say, incrementally, right. and that will delay all age-related diseases. So that's one of the big factors that we really need to move towards.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, well, I think our time is about wrapping up here. So it's been a great conversation with you, Christian. I really appreciate the time we had together.
Yeah,
and
that was terrific.
Thank you to our hosts again, the USC's Annenberg School for Communications and Journalism. And
thank you for joining us.
Thank you.